Good morning. So my talk is indeed about liquid biopsies in the pediatric solid tumors, mainly neuroblastoma. So I'm already the third speaker of the Netherlands, of Utrecht. So where is this? So the Netherlands is all the way here from here, and Utrecht is in the middle. And we have a very new hospital, a pediatric oncology hospital there. It's the Princess Máxima Center. It's there for a year now, so I thought let's show this. My talk will be about cell-free DNA. So you've heard mRNA study just now, but you also saw that still with our RNA panel, we could not identify all patients that will relapse and that will eventually die. So we're looking into other biomarkers, and cell-free DNA is really a new, well, it has been around for a few years, but it's very hip and hot to test cell-free DNA. And you can find different things. You can find point mutations, you can find copy number alterations, rearrangement, methylation. Today I will talk about methylation and I will tell you why. So cell-free DNA, it's really short fragmented DNA that is secreted by the tumor via apoptosis, necrosis, or active secretion. It's really short fragmented. It's for tumor DNA, it's around 150 base pairs. Normal cell-free DNA, as is secreted by normal cells, normal leukocytes, is 166 base pairs long. Okay. So our current strategies in liquid biopsies are the RNA MRD panel and performing shallow hole genome sequencing for the copy number alterations in the plasma, performing ddPCR for mutations on the cell-free DNA, and also whole exome sequencing of the cell-free DNA. But these methods have several drawbacks. So, for example, the shallow whole genome sequencing DNA that is not sensitive enough to use it as an MRD marker. Your sensitivity will be at maximum 10%. So, to use it as an MRD marker, that is not good enough. ddPCR, so digital droplet PCR for mutations in the cell-free DNA, only the most common mutation in neuroblastoma is ALK, and it only occurs in 8 to 10% of the patients. So we don't have one KRAS mutation that we can use for all patients. So that's also not gonna do it. Whole exome sequencing, that is really nice. Also sensitivity might be a problem, but it's very expensive now. So we have an alternative strategy. That is using the methylation of the RESV1A gene. RESV1A is a tumor suppressor gene that is frequently methylated in various cancers and also in neuroblastoma. So what do I mean with methylated? RESV1A has a lot of CpG islands, so the CG repeat, and those Cs can have an extra methyl group on them. If the gene is methylated, it's inactivated, it's a tumor suppressor gene, so that's for the tumor beneficial. In neuroblastoma, Janine Stutterheim showed already that all stage 4 tumors have RESV1A hypermethylation. So we thought we could use this as an MRD marker. Now, can we detect it in cell-free DNA, and can we use it as an MRD marker? And for that, we also compared it to our RNA panel. So what did we do? We isolated DNA from the plasma. We performed a bisulfite treatment. This bisulfite treatment will convert your cytosines in the DNA to an uracil, except the ones that have an extra methyl group. So in that way, you have a different sequence for the methylated RESV1A who will have the Cs, and the unmethylated RESV1A who will have the Us instead of a C. We also tested for albumin, actin beta as reference genes for total levels of cell-free DNA, and we compared it with our panel that Lieve showed previously. So for this feasibility study, we have 56 patients, and most of them were high risk and stage 4. And we tested also some patients with localized disease. So We tested the RESV1A qPCR in triplicate. If it was in triplicate positive, we call it truly positive. If it was in or only one or two replicates positive, we call it positive not quantifiable. So we tested 143 samples. All stage 4 patients at diagnosis were positive. For the localized stage 4S patients, half of them were positive, though not quantifiable, and half of them were negative. But also remind that not all, we could not detect all in all localized tumors RESV1A hypermethylation to begin with. So when we look at total cell-free DNA levels, so that's just albumin, actin beta, we see that compared to healthy donors, so we also tested a lot of healthy controls, neuroblastoma patients at diagnosis have higher levels of total cell-free DNA compared to the healthy controls. Also the same for a relapse. And if we now look at the cell-free DNA levels during the treatment, they go down a bit, but they're still higher than the healthy donors. Then we tested for the RESV1A hypermethylation. We saw a diagnosis, so this is only high risk and stage 4, that most of them, all of them were positive. During induction chemotherapy, that went down. At the end of induction chemotherapy, so just before stem cell transplantation or after, it was completely negative. During follow-up, some became positive again, and if patients had an event, most of them, except two, were positive again. We wondered, are the levels of cell-free DNA, are they dependent on the release of cell-free tumor DNA, so the hypermethylated RESV1A? We saw that those, still the levels, whether they were tumor positive, so cell-free tumor DNA positive or negative, they were all higher compared to the healthy controls, and there was, is this pointer working? Yeah, and there also was a difference between the RESV1A true positive that could be quantified, so the PQ, compared to the RESV1A negative ones. And we also compared them to our RNA MRD panel. We saw there is a high concordancy, especially in the both negative samples. But I think, interestingly, there's also ctDNA positive samples, which are mRNA negative. We checked all those patients at the time points where these samples were taken, and we saw that this was mainly local relapse samples or during relapse treatment. But it's really interesting and would be really good to have samples before a relapse so we can detect maybe already the tumor before it's clinically visible on imaging. So to conclude the first part, hypermethylated RESV1A can probably be used for monitoring cell-free tumor DNA in patients with neuroblastoma. There's a high concordancy, especially interesting when there's no or very low bone marrow infiltration, and we should probably use them next to each other because the other way around was also true. But we wanted to test this in a larger cohort of patients, but there are some limitations to the study I've just shown you. The cell-free DNA isolation was performed with a not isolation kits for cell-free DNA, so we could optimize this. The bisulfite conversion, it can destroy up to 90-95% of your cell-free DNA. So we want to get rid of that. And the sensitivity of qPCR for low concentrations is also not that great. So we thought, can we use the droplet digital PCR? This PCR, you divide your bulk sample into up to 20,000 droplets, and in each droplet you will perform a PCR. And then the idea is that there's in many of those droplets, there's just one copy, or maybe two, of DNA, and you will perform a PCR, and the results will be something like this. You will get droplets that are positive for the RESV1A and droplets that are positive for a reference gene. Here we choose actin beta, droplets that contain both copies, the Rusfon A and the actin beta, and droplets that contain nothing. This is still in. I will just use this slide because it's more clear. So we chose to make use of a restriction enzyme to get rid of the bisulfite treatment. So the idea is that the unmethylated Rusfon A can be cut by the restriction enzyme and will be gone. But the methylated Rusfon A, the restriction enzyme, cannot cut this. So the methylated Rusfon A will still be in your sample while the unmethylated will be gone. So we tested this in the IMR32 cell line, and it worked really well. But also the actin beta, which is here in green and is now completely gone. This should not be a problem, except that we also tested samples from healthy donors, and then you are left with only negative droplets. So if someone would perform this PCR and I would be like, oh, are you sure you put some DNA in there? Because, you know, maybe it's an empty sample. So what we did, we made use of a double reference gene, which contains also an actin beta that will not get cut. So we now have an actin beta that will get cut by the restriction enzyme and one without. And so this is now here in this amplitude, here's now the restriction enzyme that will go away after making use of the enzyme. And you can, you see it here. This is again the IMR32 cell line. Looks really nice. You can also really nicely quantify the ratio between the total DNA and cell-free tumor DNA. What does it look like in plasma? So plasma, the concentrations are much lower than on the previous pictures. And you see here, this is a Rusfon A positive plasma. You see here, there's still Rusfon A positive droplets, and there's a lot of cell-free DNA droplets as well. In healthy donor plasma, almost everything except one droplet of the methylated Rusfon A is gone. So we're now testing a lot of healthy donor plasmas to establish a nice background. We are started testing neuroblastoma samples with this as well. It's also applicable for renal tumors, rhabdomyosarcomas, and germ cell tumors. So that's what I know now. So that's actually a quite nice test. And we hope to test soon a larger cohort and publish this data. And with that, I would like to thank everyone on this slide, you for inviting me here, spasibo, that's probably the term, and thank you for your attention.